any extraneous thoughts. I try to think about what it's going to be like. I try to will the band to sound good. I try to act in a positive way. And I try to create a picture of what I hope is going to happen on the stage. So it's sort of a meditation in a way, prior to performing.
Thank you.
Of course, I was born here, number one, in Harlem, and the great excitement here in New York, of course. I always felt New York was the center of a lot of music, at least during the time when I was growing up. 52nd Street was where everybody was playing, and I had a chance to really hear some of the great musicians. And You know, it's just the energy, the wonderful energy that is in New York and nowhere else.
My first memories of Sonny Rollins is when he recorded with J.J. Johnson for Prestige. I had been hearing about him a little bit. They kept saying, there's this tenor player uptown who's really upsetting everybody. And I heard some of the test pressings on this date and was kind of impressed and was told about him in the studio, the way he stood. I guess he impressed this friend of mine who had seen him, and that he really assumed a very planted stance and dug in and just blew. And I guess the first reaction to hearing him in person was, and also on that record, was that here was a guy who had heard Charlie Parker and was putting that kind of knowledge into the tenor saxophone differently, say, than Dexter Gordon, who was acknowledged to be the first who translated Charlie Parker's mode to the tenor. Because at that time, people were very rigid, and they said, oh yes, you can sound like that on alto, like Bird, but you can't play like that on tenor. And each little step of the way had to be won in people's minds. Sonny, even in his rawest period, in that first period, when a lot of critics were putting him down, I felt he had something very, very personal and unique to say. And certainly he was not the polished Sonny Rollins that he would become, say, after the Chicago period and coming back with Max Roach and Clifford Brown and really turning everyone's heads around. That's when he really established himself. But I feel all through the earlier period, 51 through 53, he played a lot of valuable music, as we know from listening to the records.
I started listening to Sonny in 1965 and 1966, and the thing that hit me the most was the extraordinary personal authority of the man, and the way he played, and the way he addressed the audience, and the way he addressed the piece of music. The incident at the Sorgerty, where he jumped off the cliff, is not uncharacteristic of Sonny, because he always had a very strong visual sense. He's a performer who likes to keep the audience entertained. I remember the one time there was a concert in 66 called Titans of the Tenor that he shared a bill on with Coleman Hawkins, Zoot Sims, and John Coltrane. And when Sonny was, Dave Lambert was the MC, and he said, and now Sonny Rollins. And a much shorter fellow walked out. It was Yusef Lateef, whom Sonny had just convinced to come along for the gig, who was not billed. And after Yusef played several choruses, Sonny walked out all in black, black kid sneakers, black pants, black t-shirt, walked straight to the back of the auditorium, the back of the stage, and started to improvise chords behind Lateef, and then came up for I think he was playing Hold 'Em Joe, a calypso, and then went into a whole incredible 15, 20 minute solo thing. And the control of the horn, the time, the phrasing, everything about it just held you in your seat. And so even if you were a novice, as I was at that time, there was something about Rollins that was so compelling that you understood him. I never understood that. I used to see reviews where people would talk about him being too complex or intellectual. And the great thing about Rollins is that he is a communicator. He always tells a story. I think he's the most compelling tenor saxophonist we have right now.
Whenever talking about Sonny Rollins, I almost feel the need to preface anything I might say by pointing out that I consider him the greatest living jazz improviser. Of course, that puts the standards higher by which you have to judge Sonny Rollins, and you can only imagine the standards by which he must judge himself. Playtime for us is work time for him. I mean, we just go to enjoy his concerts. To him, it means something else. Something much greater seems to be at stake, and I think some of that tension communicates itself to an audience and becomes pretty fascinating.
I dropped out of the jazz scene in 1959, which was more well known. That was the bridge period when I practiced on the bridge for a while. As you know, I'm always trying to improve myself, and I'm partly a self-taught musician, and I'm all my career I've been trying to improve my craft. So at that point I had dropped out and figured I'd stay away from music and the music scene and everybody and just try to improve my playing, and I studied pianoforte again. And so I just, that was a very important period, a publicized period. I had been practicing on the bridge, and I think a jazz writer had seen us on the bridge, or seen me on the bridge practicing, and he wrote a little story about it, and it became famous, infamous Sonny Rollins practicing alone on the bridge. So when I finally came back to the jazz scene, and I came back to appearing, I was appearing in the nightclub, and I made my debut again. I recorded for RCA at that time, and we thought, well, it would be apropos if we named the album The Bridge, or at least some songs from the album.
Although I never saw Sonny Rollins practicing on the bridge, I did see him blowing into a little closet in his apartment on Grand Street. He used that to muffle the sound so he wouldn't bother anybody, and he could play at any hour. He also had a board on which he did exercises. He was drinking orange juice. He was into Rosicrucianism, and a complete contrast from the guy who had been strung out a few years earlier. So he did a complete about-face. He started really working on physical fitness, and he knew that in order to be a tenor player, to have the endurance to play that instrument, that he had to be in shape, and he talked about this.
Any instrument eventually gets to be a part of the person playing it. It's a very personal thing. And the saxophone is closer to me, I hate to say it's almost closer than Lucille. But she knows this already, so she's not jealous, you know. Before I was married to Lucille, though, I did have problems with girlfriends and my saxophone, though, I must say that, you know, and one of them broke up my saxophone at one time when she was mad at me. I was playing a very important job at the five spot with Mingus and a lot of people. But the saxophone is very close to you, you know, and it's a very delicate instrument, and the slightest thing can change the nuance that you put into it. So it can drive you crazy. It can drive you crazy because even if you know what you want to play, sometimes it doesn't come out because of differences in the horn, and it might not be working exactly right or something like that. So it's a very close relationship, you know.
Obviously, I think he's important. And just as obviously, I have a hard time explaining why to a general audience, you know, why he is so important. It's almost got to be accepted. In one sense, he's never been as influential at any given period as, say, Miles Davis. Well, as Miles Davis has been throughout Miles Davis's own whole career, but he's never been as important as Miles. He's never been as influential as Coltrane was in the mid to late '60s, or Ornette Coleman during much of that same time. And I think one of the reasons is he's never, unlike them, he never formed a band in his own image. I mean, he's never been successful at doing that. And in a way, that almost enhances his appeal, that lack of context. It's just Sonny Rollins as the single most excellent standard of jazz you can possibly imagine.
Of course, jazz is a music that's made by people playing together, but the master improvisers are always the ones who set the tone, they take the lead, they bring everyone in around them. And Sonny Rollins is someone who has listened to all the great players before him and come up with something of his own, and that's the way the music moves along. His tone is so personal, that deep sound of his is like no other saxophonist. His sense of time, the rhythmic displacement, his pauses, his rests, the way he then comes rushing up from behind the beat, his ability to play at length, I think, and still come up with interesting ideas is something that stands out in my mind.
One of the most important aspects of Sonny's influence on jazz is his ability to improvise an extended solo and keep your attention and not just go through the cycle of choruses and chords. I guess the first examples were, again, an unlikely song, Irving Berlin's There's No Business Like Show Business, and There Are Such Things, which has a terrific cadenza at the end. And he figured out how to alternate the chorus and the verse in such a way to constantly keep you a little bit off balance while you're listening to the performance. And then he developed this in the subsequent record with a piece called Blues 7. And in writing about that, Gunther Schuller coined the phrase thematic improvisation. All he meant by that was that Sonny will take a theme and he will use the melody to govern the improvisational ideas that follow rather than simply playing rote on the chord changes. And actually, Rollins has a lot of different ways that he organizes improvisations, but the end product is that, combining them together, he manages to sustain interest for, say, 5, 6 choruses, 10, 12 minutes, in a way that very few improvisers have ever been able to do. And it never becomes just a self-indulgent howl or a kind of emotional outpouring. It's always logical. It's always a kind of Aristotelian perfection, a beginning and a middle and an end, and he takes you someplace and you know where he's going. And one of the pitfalls of that kind of playing is that with Sonny, as I mentioned earlier, there's no hiding for him. You always know when he's playing very well and when he's not, because it's all right there on the plate for you.
Whenever I try to create anything solos when I'm playing, what I'm basically trying to do is to blot out my mind as much as possible. And of course, I've already learned the material. So after learning the material, then I try to blot out my mind and just let it flow by itself. So I try not to really think too much about what I'm playing, when I'm soloing. So I sort of have the structure already, and then I just try to create and let it come by itself, you know. Thank you. Certain points during my playing, I leave the stage. Sometimes I go out into the audience and I get feedback from the audience. They stimulate me to do more and to get into different areas. And this is sort of what I had in mind when I was doing that concert. I figured that I would leave the stage, jump down off of the stage, and then come back on the stage. And at first, I know I looked and I figured it might be too steep, but I thought I could manipulate it, and I tried. Of course, I didn't. And it was unfortunate because I did sustain a broken heel. But I kept playing, and I was very happy about that. And I was happy that a lot of the people didn't realize that I was actually hurt or anything, and they thought it was just a part of the performance.
At the time that Sonny came along, jazz was grappling with the problem of standards and how to play them and what to do to find new material. The previous generation, Parker and Gillespie, had taken a lot of standard tunes and written their own chords and their own melodies and added substitute chords to the original chord progressions. But Rollins went back and found all kinds of pieces that jazz musicians did not know what to do with or would not have known what to do with if he hadn't played them. Things like Jolson songs and I'm an Old Cowhand, Toot Toot Tootsie, and all kinds of ballads, and he made them credible as music, let alone as jazz music. He proved that and Miles Davis is someone else who did this, that if you find the right tempo, the right attack, the right approach for a piece of music, you can make it work for you. And so Rollins, even at the height of free jazz, never had to turn away from that. The whole standards record he did, a lot of those standards weren't really standards until he brought them back into the jazz milieu.
Right. He one time described it as, I was starting to do a list of them, and he said, he named a few others, and he said, songs no one ever recorded before, and no one will ever record again. And somebody else pointed out to me when I told that to them, of course they never record them again. It's because Sonny has made the definitive versions. Yeah, it'd be crazy to record some of those songs again.
Well, I met Lucille in Chicago when I was playing with Max Roach's group. And Lucille was a friend of a friend of mine. Actually, there was a musician that I was rehearsing with at the time. And this musician had a girlfriend who was a girlfriend of Lucille's, so they both got together, I think, and came down to see us play someplace.
The same girl or woman that Sonny talked about, who was my friend, had told me a lot about Sonny. And so she sort of wanted us to sort of meet. And when I met him, I sort of knew right away that this was going to be something special. I don't believe he did, but I did. And I sort of was determined that this was the guy, you know. She told me not to do this because she said, you're gonna get hurt and don't get involved. Just have a good time, but don't get involved. But I did. I did the booking for a long time. Now I just do the managing and occasional booking.
Occasionally booking.
But I love it. And the producing came about because I was always involved anyway. And starting about 78, there was a particularly difficult record, the Don't Stop the Carnival album, which was there were great problems with that album, and Sonny was reluctant to go in the studio to mix it. So Oren and I, Oren Keepnews, who was Sonny's producer at that time, decided that if Sonny would let us, we would mix it to sort of spare him. And he said, I think he was sort of at the point, he said, okay, go ahead. And so then it just changed from there. And finally we decided that we wanted to do everything, I think, our own way, instead of having anybody else to sort of say, do this way or this way or this way. We wanted to do it the way that Sonny was most comfortable for Sonny. And it wasn't anything against Oren, because we're still friends, but it was just, we wanted to do it all our own way.
Sonny Rollins on records is very often not the Sonny Rollins that we hear live. When I first started reading jazz criticism and listening to records, I remember a critic reviewing the recording he made for RCA in the early 60s of If Ever I Would Leave You, and saying it's a good record, but it certainly can't compare with the extraordinary performance he gave at such and such a place. And I thought, this is remarkable. It seemed to me, I was very naive, of course, and I thought, it's amazing that they wouldn't keep doing takes until they got something as good. But really, that's been a constant throughout his career. We all have memories of some To a Wild Rose that he played that we'll never forget, and the version on the record isn't quite up to that. Every time, for a long time in the mid-70s, whenever I reviewed Sonny in concert, I would get letters from people around the country telling me that I was nuts. How can you compare the latest Sonny Rollins record with Way Out West or Saxophone Colossus or Workout? And I would always tell them, you know, you have to see him live. And then finally, in the late 70s, or I guess it was, or maybe the early 80s, Fantasy put out Don't Stop the Carnival. And it's got two performances on it, Silver City and Autumn Nocturne, that are among the great Rollins masterpieces. And two of the people who had written me those letters wrote me back and said, just heard that record, now I understand what you were talking about. So Rollins really is the ultimate example of a musician who proves the old adage about jazz, which is that the music is very much a process of communication between a player and the audience. And sometimes, for Sonny, it just does not happen when he's playing to a glass booth.
In his defense, though, Barry, don't you think the records are getting better?
Oh, yes. I'm glad you said that.
He's abandoned that approach of bringing in Donald Byrd or whatever.
Ever since Sonny and Lucille started producing them themselves, I think the records have gotten better.
I get very angry, and I get these nice fantasies. I think I told you about one of having a jazz critic up to a 39th floor apartment and telling them to look out the window and just step further. All these nice, I have very nice fantasies.
I've always wanted, actually, to work in different musical environments. The opportunity to do this piece came about through my sponsors here in Japan. And they asked me what I'd like to do an orchestral piece this time around. So, of course, I said, I'd love to do it. I've never done anything quite like this before. And because of that, of course, I sought the help of a good friend of mine, old musical companion of mine, Heikki Sarmanto.
I was in South America doing some playing. and I came back to Helsinki. I flew first to New York and stayed there one day. And I was trying to call my old friend Sonny Rollins, but I couldn't reach him in New York. I spent there only one night, and then I continued back home to Helsinki. And as I walked into my apartment with all the luggage in my hand, the phone rings. And guess who it is? It's Sonny. And Sonny says, I have this thing in Japan. Would you be interested?
The themes were mine. I labored over them for some time, trying to come up with what would sound proper in this context. And I asked Heikki to orchestrate them for me and to also conduct the orchestra for me.
Back to the beginning, and then the trumpets are beginning of that letter again. Trumpets are coming in. Tick, 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 tick.
Thing is that those ideas he had originally created, those little thematic patterns, they were so incredibly strong, melodic, very meaningful melodies. They were the seed for this whole piece. If you have even a tiny little thematic pattern, just a couple of bars, but if it's really good, strong, original line, from that you can make a whole big tree grow up.
I have been called a spontaneous orchestrator, so on. So, of course, this is not a spontaneous orchestration in that sense, but I hope to bring some of those qualities to this piece in that I will still be improvising myself on many sections of it. No two performances of this concerto will be alike. And in that sense, it will be true to sort of what I'm about. It is very much structured. And what will be different will be my relation to the structure. Each time will be different.
Thank you.
violas playing that. They should be a, because they keep the whole thing together.
Yeah,
a little soft there.
I think it's going to be a dynamite concert. It's not probably like most of premieres, it's not going to be technically finished yet, but it will have the first performance excitement.
I'm actually quite excited about it and looking forward to it.
I first came to Japan some time ago, I was very pleased to find that the Japanese fans were very much aware of the birth dates and the history of all of the jazz musicians, myself included. And I was very much excited about that. And I find that they're a very good audience, very fine audience. They take their music very seriously. They keep up with everything that's happening, all of the latest developments in the music.
These musicians here in the symphony orchestra, they are just amazingly professional. It's a very difficult piece of music, my goodness, and they have never been playing this type of music, because frankly, I have never heard this type of piece being written for symphony orchestra. So this whole experience was very new for all of us, for Sonny, myself, and the orchestra.
I try to always inject my work with a spiritual quality. It sounds kind of grandiose to put it in that way, but I have studied Zen in Japan here. I did a study. I studied yoga in India. Of course, I was born a Christian in the United States. And I found elements of all these religions that are quite similar in many ways. So philosophy, religion, spirituality, all of these things is never very far away from what I'm doing at any time. And I'm sure that when I'm playing here in Japan, that's the case, as it is when I'm playing in the United States and other parts of the world. my parents come from the Caribbean area of the world, the islands, and it might be significant that Japan, of course, is an island. And, you know, on our last trip to Japan, there's an area of Japan near Hiroshima. And we were traveling from one part of Japan to another, and we're nearing Hiroshima. And I happened to, it was striking, the resemblance between the island and the area in the Caribbean was very much similar. And it never really occurred to me until then, but it so happened that after that, not too long after that, a Japanese friend of mine brought up the fact that perhaps this is the reason why I'm so liked in Japan, because there's something, the island connection is there in some mysterious way, you know. So being a guy that's kind of mysterious myself, I thought, you know, hey, it's all right. Why not? You know, so I'm all for it if that's happening.